distinguished speaker coming from the United States to give this presentation. Dr. Michael Segal is the founder and the chief scientist for SimulConsult. I know Dr. Segal for 15 years or more. I mean, he will be giving us a very interesting talk about how we use artificial intelligence and how can we utilize these sophisticated tools in diagnosing genetic and rare diseases. So,
thank you. We're moving from one talk about AI to talk about the other AI. So I'm going to start with a really practical issue in the medicine of reassessing diagnosis, including reanalysis of genomic information. And it turns out that to really understand that gives you insights into artificial intelligence, not just in diagnosis, but the future of where it's going to be going in general. And it may seem surprising, but I think I'll be able to convince you of that. So starting from the practical point, so outside the Middle East, there's not that much consanguinity. You make a diagnosis and you're done. If you have no diagnosis, you reassess every once in a while to try to figure out what's going on. In the Middle East, it's much harder because you make a diagnosis and they explain only part of it, and you have to keep thinking there might be more, and because of the consanguinity, and I'll explain what's labeled as query on the top with all the colored text is a case as we used it in diagnosing, in testing our diagnostic software, where clinicians would use it before and after the diagnostic assistance. The colored text is a coloration that I put in of what I thought were positive findings in green, permanent negative findings in red, and findings incorrectly interpreted by ChatGPT in purple. And here's the response of saying, this looks like Prader-Willi syndrome. And it turns out that's wrong. This is not Prader-Willi syndrome at all. And even some of the information given about Prader-Willi syndrome is wrong. And typically it's information that was present in articles about differential diagnosis and so forth. And we ran through a bunch of cases from this paper and also ones which were used for the Child Neurology Society case-based education. We basically find 100% diagnostic error. And Stephen Wolfram found much the same thing with math problems, that lots and lots of errors and just really serious errors. And so it really raises the question of how do we make artificial intelligence work better with information we have that can solve problems that have a correct answer. Because ChatGPT is, if you're a foreign policy person or a poet, this will give you output that seems very much like the output of your colleagues, but not in math, not in medicine, and our task is to fix that. So what's going wrong here? There's a phenomenon called premature closure, of coming to a diagnosis and fixating on that. And in medicine, we have a concept of a differential diagnosis. We don't have a closure. We have a whole bunch of things that we're considering. Furthermore, we come back and ask you about more stuff that you try to come up with what will distinguish among the diseases and differential diagnosis. And one of the other problems with premature closure for machine learning is rare diseases. You're not going to find much information, and machine learning is going to focus on the more common ones. And, you know, that's helpful for some people, but for us, trying to diagnose rare diseases, it's sort of leaving out what really matters most. Another issue is the lack of explainability. You saw there that there was this description of Prader-Willi syndrome that was semi-accurate and no description of how it came to the conclusion. There's also secrecy about the findings, like which one, it was my coloration of the findings that said which ones were used. There's no information about the onset age, pertinent negatives, you have no idea what's being used, and there's a real danger of garbage in, garbage out. And a more serious problem is wrong information. So for VEXAS, it wouldn't have the correct information, but it's knowable now, and basically what should be able to use new information. Findings, there can be errors about it, that knowledge has advanced. And even the existence of a disease, there's diseases that disappear because we decided they were a mistake. So it has to deal with all of this kind of stuff. And in augmented intelligence approaches, we do. And it doesn't look like this is going to be very readable, but what we have here on the left column is a differential diagnosis of given these findings. And we'll discuss how we get findings into the software. What you can sort of half make out here is that there's onset ages for findings and there's pertinent negative findings. And in blue is an indication of the probability. Here we have a very strong probability of Alister-Gillian syndrome, which was the diagnosis in that case. And what we have here filled out in green is a metric of pertinence, which all clinicians know that a pertinent finding is one that really has affected the differential diagnosis. And you'll see why it's important to focus on that when we get to some of the genomic and microarray analysis. So differential diagnosis is very important. And it's important because we use convince yourself whether these other machines are at fault. So Reanalysis is fairly